Well, if you've stayed with the videos this long, congratulations, because we are really getting into to the nitty-gritty and the clarity of it all. It's just tremendous, just tremendous what's happening right now, the clarity about the whole situation. And I expected this. I trusted it. And that this is the key. Trust it. It will come, it will come, it will come. So we will see if this can come out in some way here. But, you know, we're not into some super hurry. We could talk about Facebook first. Facebook's quite odd. I've been going on Facebook now and posting a lot. And it's just very strange place. There's an etiquette there. And almost nobody comments on anything. They just like. And nobody has a conversation on Facebook, actually. They really don't. There's no conversations take place. So I'm like the only one writing, you know, a paragraph or something of you know, sharing clarity. No. Just like. I'm like, what? Why are people commenting more? What is going on? It is really odd. Very odd culture on Facebook. The whole thing is just bizarre. Everyone acts like they're texting each other or something. I mean, really? So are all our conversations now down to texting? That's pretty far removed from what we need to be experiencing, just as this culture is very far removed from what we need to be experiencing. Now, we've talked about the crisis of despair that is coming. It's a convergence. It's like a massive earthquake that produces an uplift of the ocean, and that uplift travels across the ocean, and it doesn't seem like much. Maybe a buoy rises by a couple inches or something, you know, in a long wave sort of way. It's a very long wave, actually. And when it gets to close, that long wave starts stacking up. So there's a lot of water coming in, actually. It just doesn't seem like a big wave out in the ocean at all. But once it gets to the shallower reef by the land, then it starts stacking up, slowing down, stacking up, and then the water pushes inland. You have a tsunami. It's the same way you're having a tsunami of despair. We've had this massive 100-year earthquake, almost, really, of building up the attitudes that generate despair. When we undercut religion and the belief in the grace of God, then we start building up severe despair. And this is what's happened for the last 100 years here in this planet. So the tsunami is about ready to hit our shores. They say July 24th, we should start showing up. Then through the 29th, there's going to be some sort of like a despair tsunami coming in this summer. Now, so I'm very aware of this, and I've been studying how everyone's preparing for this, and it's becoming very evident now, and it's very simple. Okay, I'll tell you how simple it is. They either are going to trust in the matriarchy to deal with the despair, or trust in the patriarchy, or trust in a combination of the matriarchy and patriarchy, a compromise type of thing. Okay, now, so it's really that simple. If you look at it this way, everything is going to start clarifying for you. Just trust it. It will clarify for you. It really will. Now, the issue is despair and what to do about despair. And the answer is you don't do anything about despair. You refuse to, what you say is that it's a thought of despair in relation to a thought of a self. It's the imaginary thought self that's experiencing imaginary thought despair. But the real self, which is what we really are, is not experiencing any despair. Oh, there's no despair at all. It's impossible. So you would say, well, why are we dreaming of imaginary self and having imaginary despair and suffering and all that? What it really is a hypothetical scenario designed to try and prepare us for what we feel we're going to experience when we finally are able to separate from God, because we desire to separate from God. But the answer to all of this is we can't separate from God. So we don't need an imaginary self suffering imaginary despair, like a dress rehearsal for what we think we're going to feel, the real self, if we somehow manage to split ourselves in half, right? Reality splits itself in half. It's never going to happen. It's never going to happen. So there's no reason at all to have this dream scenario, this dress rehearsal for what we think is some, you know, terrible feeling is going to strike us or something. No terrible feeling is going to strike us. So in no way should we try to cure despair. What we need to do is realize that we are, that mind needs to realize it's mind. It's okay. Everything's okay with mind. This imaginary mind is not mind. I mean, it's a projection of mind, but imaginary mind is not the quality of the true mind, okay? It doesn't have that. It's just an image, a thought form, a belief. So the belief self is not the real self. And so there's nothing we need to do with the belief self at all. We just need to realize that we're still the real self. So mind has to recognize mind, and this is what the Dharma kings tell us, and this is what they're so great at helping us with, is mind recognizing mind. That's all we have to do. This is the cure for what ails us, actually, is simply mind say, "Oh, I'm mind. I thought I was something else, you know, but no, I really am mind. Oh, well, everything's fine. Of course." That's it. As Longchenpa says, there's just one intuitive insight cuts through everything. And it's gone. No more suffering. Just one intuitive insight, which is, I really am mind. Mind recognizing mind. So this only the Dharma kings and their courts, which are the gurus, the masters, the Dharma princes, and the courtiers, and those of you know who are trusting in that, only they really know this fact and how to help mind recognize mind. So I say, as an ambassador of the Dharma Kings, working in the court of the Dharma King Longchenpa, what I say is that we must turn to the Dharma Kings and pay attention to what they say and the practices that they give us. They have the right information. And the approach of the matriarchy and the patriarchy and a combination of the matriarchy and patriarchy, not only does it not work, it makes it worse. It makes it worse. The more we try to make an illusion true and then cure it, the stronger the illusion becomes for us and actually makes it worse. So I am saying, let us place our trust in the Dharma Kings, Jesus Christ, Longchenpa, Ramana Maharshi, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, Jamyang Chokyi, Kensi Chokyi Lodro, and then their associates, you might say, the Dharma Kings and their associates, the Bodhisattvas, the associates, their associates, which are high, you know, gurus, masters like Nisargadatta Maharaj, for instance, Punja Ji, for instance, and you know, you can bring up many, many names throughout history. Of great gurus that are, you know, masters that are enlightened. They don't quite have the experience, the overall experience of the Dharma Kings, but they're colleagues and close associates. So we really need to put ourselves in the court of the Dharma Kings and trust what they have to tell us, because what they have to tell us is totally different than what the matriarchy or patriarchy or a combination of the two have to tell us. They simply are clueless about what to do about what really ails us, you know, which is nothing at all. And so the way is to make assertions that there's absolutely nothing wrong with me. I've never experienced any trouble whatsoever. Never. I've never been, you know, been bothered in the slightest by anything. These are the assertions we need to make to help mind recognize, hey, I really am mind. Because mind can't be bothered by anything. So to think that we're bothered means mind doesn't believe that it's mind. It means there's some other mind that we thinks that's what it is. It thinks it's this belief mind with, you know, in having a belief body in a belief world, suffering, belief, despair. None of that's true at all. So what we do is these super positive affirmations is what we do. Super positive affirmations like, I've always been blissful. I've always only experienced bliss. I've never experienced anything other than bliss. There's nothing other. There's nothing to experience except bliss. Nothing whatsoever. And we keep on these super. This is the right approach. Okay, this is the right approach. Now, the other approaches are disastrous. They compound despair, actually. And the situation we're in right now is a result of 100 years of compounding despair. We've really, really, really gotten away from the grace of God. It's very important to believe in a higher realm, a God, a grace of God, prayer, all that is super important. And we're about to find out what happens when we turn our backs on that. because we're going to have this convergence of overconfidence in the ego, the matriarchy, patriarchy, combination of the two, or combination of the two. This is the ego. And this is humanist, flesh-based advice, and thinking, well, and what has it gotten us? Well, you know, pharmaceutical medicine, right? And all these therapies are supposed to de-stress us and stuff. And we're more jittery, and deep down we're very disturbed. Actually, everybody in the world is suffering from chronic severe despair. They don't even realize it because it seems all normal. Everybody, you know, is just, everybody's this way. But actually, it's actually a totally severe crisis throughout the whole world. Everyone is actually in chronic despair. At least imaginary despair, you would say. And so they go to the shrinks, they go to the, you know, medicine, they go to all these stuff, the drugs, sex, drugs, rock and roll, and everything in between to try and, you know, I don't feel quite right. I don't, you know, not, it only makes it worse. It only makes it worse. So what we will have going forward in this world, and you can see it very clearly in American politics, as I say, all politics is spiritual politics. You have one side that it wants, says, hey, the matriarchy knows how to help with despair. That's the right way to go. We're, the mothers always know how to comfort the children when they're in despair. We know how to do it. You know, us women, you know, we're natural at it. That's what they claim. Of course, their way only makes it worse, actually. Much, much worse. Terrible. Then you have the other side, which is more the patriarchal side, that says no, you know, we're the ones that can really get it done. We know how to really push and be intense and you know, work really hard at it, and be very industrious, and we'll get it done because we have this ingenuity, industrious and stuff. That's more the patriarchal mindset. Of course, they don't know what they're doing either at all. Actually, I know some of you are saying, whoa, wait a minute. No, just bear with us. And then there's others that believe, oh, we're so good at compromising. We'll take a little of the matriarchy, a little of the patriarchy, blend them together, and, you know, and we'll get this beautiful compromise. And of course, this will work. And those are the most dangerous of all. Those are the most dangerous of all. Because they're very sly, and it seems like they're always, agreeing. Yeah, okay, yeah, we can work with this. We can work with this. And taking some from both is just, you know, making it, you know, confusing, and also it's totally ineffective. So not only is it totally ineffective, it's also very confusing. It's almost better to just have, you know, either matriarchy or patriarchy, and at least you know they don't know what they're talking about, and you know, it's more direct. But when you get this compromise, then it becomes, you know, very, very deceptive and tricky. It's kind of like, I'll take zero from here and zero from here and mix, you know, and mix it up and put a bow on it. And what do you have? You got zero with a bow on it, which is even worse than, you know, zero over here and zero over here. I'll sprinkle perfume on this, you know, you get this zero over here smells bad. Zero over here smells bad. I'll put it together, sprinkle perfume, put a bow on it. And what do you have? Look at this. Isn't this nice? Yeah, it's zero. it's you know, it's trouble. And so the Dharma kings are experts in this situation. And having gone through all of this myself, I'm working to become more and more and more proficient about recognizing all this. And Longchenpa said, you recognize it enough to be recognized as someone who has some authority in this area of despair, because as my whole life has been severe despair. So I had to look into it and say, what is really going on here? And you find out the answer is very different than you expect. Very, very different than you expect. It's make-believe despair for a make-believe self. Neither one is real. And so the true self is never experienced any despair. Well, it can't. It's impossible. Cannot. And so enlightenment is realizing your true self and realizing that everything that's happening, this false self, is not really happening to any self at all. It's all fantasy coming from the same source, which is the real self is having this fantasy, wanting to figure out how to deal with whatever troubles might come when it separates from God, which it's trying to do, which it can't do, cannot do. So all this experimentation is worthless, is absolutely worthless. So the United States is a perfect example of what's going on in the politics. You know, the Republicans, the Democrats, one is a matriarchy, one's a patriarchy. Okay, and this is the battle that's going on around the world. And people are saying, should we allow, you know, should we deal with this terrible despair that's coming because we've turned our back on God and grace and the Holy Spirit and prayer and all of this stuff. We have radically turned our back on it. Radically. We don't understand how drastic, what a drastic crisis this is. Because without those, we're going to really believe that the body and the world and existence and time all is real, and this is all there is, and so we've really got to cure despair. You see, whereas a religious viewpoint says suffering and despair, all this, I know there's a higher realm. I know that God has a higher purpose for me. This is not that important. So don't let me try to develop all these medicines, and I'll suffer. It's okay. And so their view of suffering is very, very different. Very different. Now, here, it's like the slightest bit of suffering, everybody freaks out. It's unbelievable how brittle people are. They can't handle anything because they think that this is it. So we've got to be happy with this life. Whereas the religious viewpoint, it says, happiness with this life is not important. It's not important. That's very crucial insight to have. It's very crucial faith to have. So the best people in the world right now, the most helpful, are the ones who tell if someone comes to you with troubles, like a mother, for instance, a child and stuff, and she says, look, you know, pray to Jesus, pray to God, pray to the Holy Spirit, pray to Krishna, pray to, you know, Buddha, whatever you want to do, go to your rabbi, whatever, and ask God for help. That's a wise mother. Those are wise parents. The parents could say that. She says, look, you know, my comforting is just going to, you know, it's not really the real comfort you need. You need spiritual comfort. And I can't give that to you. Only God can give that to you. Now, this is the attitude that we used to have here. So we had a more religious world instead of a matriarchal or a patriarchal or a combination world. Is both the men and women, matriarchy and patriarchy, realize to some extent that they don't have the answer. God has the answer. Holy Spirit, or whatever you want, the grace of God has the answer for us. But the answer is very mysterious, you know. And we're taught that you know, say God is very mysterious, meaning really means the way that it really is very mysterious to us. And yet we have faith. There is some answer, and we trust in it. This is called a religious society, and this is that's the right way to deal with the situation culturally. That's the right way to do it. Now we have demolished that structure now in this world. Demolished it. Again, when's the last time you saw someone in public praying? At dinner table, we pray before a restaurant, we pray. Never seen it. I don't see anybody doing that. No way. Praying before in your house. When's the last time you pray before a meal? Pray before you go to bed. Pray when you get up in the morning. Pray before you drive. I try to do all this stuff. There's a culture of prayer has been under absolute assault by the humanists. Driving it out of school, driving it out of public places, taking down, you know, the icons and various statues and everything. The atheists have been after it severely. This has done massive damage to our culture, to the world culture. And this is now one of the reasons why we're in a crisis of despair. When we turn our back on God, we turn to materialism. And when we do that, this generates a massive inner despair in us, which begins to surface. It takes a while to surface. We fight it off with sex, drugs, and rock and roll. We fight it off. And eventually, though, it's going to surface. It's going to surface. And then that's when things really hit the fan. Really hit the fan badly. So we're in for big trouble here in this world. And predicting what forms of trouble take, you know, that I'm just saying in general, I'm not going to try to predict exactly at this point what exact forms are going to take, but you have the manic, I think the matriarchy, usually people will react in a more manic way to their efforts to cure things. And the patriarchy, people react more in depressive ways, very depressive ways. And then a combination of the two, trying to mix the two, you become manic depressive. So you're headed for this manic world and a depressed world and a manic depressive world, and all of the massive confusion that this generates. where your mind, you just don't know what's going on. I mean, it's just what in the heck? Well, it's frantic efforts to dispel despair, which in our attempts to dispel despair, it actually makes it worse. See, it's like pouring gasoline on a fire. The way that the matriarchy and the patriarchy and the combination of the two go about trying to deal with despair is like fighting fire with more fire. Hey, there's a fire. Let's pour gasoline on it. You know, let's make it bigger. Oh yeah, that's great. Or trying to dry something out by pouring water on it. I mean, it doesn't work. It makes it worse. It makes it worse. And we kick the can down the road, keep kicking it down the road, but at some point, it gets us. And apparently, it's about ready to get us. The signs are certainly there of a convergence, a very big convergence. And again, the inner trouble is this feeling of something's, you know, drastically wrong, and I feel cut off from myself, you know, despair. I can't find the way home. I don't know what to do about it. I feel in prison. It's this deep spiritual despair that arises, which religion actually orients us in the right direction. Most people don't understand that. They're so critical of it. But the fact is, belief in a higher power, in God, a creator, that you're created. You're not evolved, you're created. Okay, it's very important to realize you are not evolved, you are created. You're not a body. The body's not that important. And there's a higher heavenly realm. This world is not your home at all. Jesus told us, no, this is not your home at all. And suffering is not important. Don't worry. You know, God's not judging you for your life here in this world, really. Jesus said God's a God of just love. There's no judgment in God, really. All this is super important. To pray and call upon the grace of God to clear your mind and give you the answers instead of appealing to the flesh, to the matriarch, to the mother, to the patriarch, to the father, a combination. Appealing to that is appealing to the ego. It's appealing to the ego. So we're getting very clear, you know, it's sorting itself out, and we're starting to see, wow, okay, yeah. So we call upon the Dharma Kings, Padmasambhava, Dharma King, Padmasambhava, add him to the mix, absolutely. Wow, what a great Dharma King. Ah, that's redundant, but Padmasambhava is, super heavyweight in Tibetan Buddhism. Just a super, super heavyweight. So I've been praying to him some. It's powerful. It's the Tibetans just bank on him to a tremendous extent. Yeah, you know, so there's got to be something there. They just act like he has the most tremendous grace that they can count on him. So Pay attention. The Tibetans often know what they're talking about. They know their business. So Padmasambhava, by all means, call upon Padmasambhava, Guru Rinpoche. He's a Dharma King. Just wow, what power! It's just what grace he has. Just extraordinary. And we would be fools not to call upon it, all the grace that we can get, and. Because the world is so hooked on this matriarchal thing and this patriarchal thing and trying to combine the two thing, they're so anti, you know, God and grace and stuff like that. It's not so easy to call. It's not as easy as it used to be. It used to be you just call on Jesus and everyone supports you, your community supports you, and it's just like you can really feel the grace coming from Jesus. Now you feel like you might be arrested if you call on Jesus. I mean, if you stand out in a corner, Jesus, God, you know, they'll probably call 911 or you got a 5150 here. You know, some lunatic is a dangerous lunatic, a religious lunatic. Well, who knows what they're going to do? Maybe they're going to commit some atrocity or something. You know, it's just the pressure on religious people is just insane right now. The humanists are losing their minds. They're going batty, completely batty. They're so confused, actually. So super confused. They're getting things upside down and backwards to an extreme extent. Now, very ominous portent I had today. I actually prayed to Padmasambhava, and right away I got this response. It said, your cousin that just died in a rollover. Do you remember some dream that you had? And I suddenly said, oh my gosh, yes. Because about almost, you know, about, well, how many years ago? 17 years ago, I guess. I had this dream. It had to be more than that. It had to be like almost, you know, almost 19 years ago, maybe 1998 or something. I had a dream where it was clear I was being shown the future. It was amazing. It was the way it was presented was like it rolled out, and I was witnessing, and this timeline went past me, kind of, and I was witnessing all these events. And I realized that this was showing me what was to come. And in this dream, I saw, you know, George Bush being elected president, you know, the second one. And I had no idea who he was at that time. No idea. I don't follow politics really. But these initials were right there, and it was clear that he was inaugurated in the dream as president. So when that happened, I said, "Whoa!" I remember the dream. I said, "Wow." Because I was kind of, the dream was so intense, I've always stayed aware of it. And then in the dream I saw these airplanes suddenly come out of nowhere and strike the area around the president, so to speak, which I saw striking the nation, the United States, and causing this tremendous instability, which that was 9/11. I was shown 9/11 in the dream. And when 9/11 happened, I said, ah, yeah, that's exactly what I was shown. Suicide attack. But it was very odd what happened. And then I was shown the instability, swerving back and forth and trying to stay on the road. It was very difficult to stay on the road. I saw that the psyche of the country and even the world was going to be kind of going very unstable. Finally, towards the end of the dream, I saw a bunch of other stuff that has come true, actually. And towards the end of the dream, I remember the penultimate situation was this car flipped over, had a terrible rollover accident. And I said, oh my gosh, this is horrible, but this should be okay, right? And then I was given the word later that no, they died, the driver died. And I was devastated. I said, oh, that's horrible. Well, that's what happened to my cousin just a couple days ago. And she was a paragon of America, actually, a paragon. The model American woman, you know, really was upper middle class, wealthy upper middle class, but charity, philanthropy, friendship, just helping everybody. I mean, she just, and you know, rollover. And I said, okay, well, she'll, you know, it'll take a while to recover. When I heard that she died, I was very shocked. And we think that the cars these days are safe. And I talked to someone today who explained to me, no, not at all, not in rollovers, not at all. The air bags are designed for collisions, not rollovers. They probably don't even deploy in rollovers. And your seat belts also are designed to catch you going forward, but in a side thing where you're being violently tossed side to side, etc., they don't help you very much at all, actually. And so you're in a rollover, you're in extreme trouble, to say the very least. And there's really nothing to grab. I'm driving my vehicle, I'm saying, look, what if I had a rollover? What do I do? I said, man, I can't. I said, grab the steering wheel. And I was told, no. Because when rollover, the front wheels are frantically flipping like this back and forth. And the steering wheel is just spinning like crazy. And it rips it right out of your hands. You can't grab a hold of it at all. It'll spin you. It'll flip you. So that's not it. So I was thinking, well, what do I do? And I couldn't figure anything out, actually. Except, you know what I figured out? Pray. When you have a rollover, you just pray. Have absolute confidence in God, the grace of God, and just pray. Say, I want to be okay from this, and I don't need troubles or injuries or death or anything. I'll stick it out. What's to come? So that's what I came up with. You better pray. You better know how to pray in a rollover. People see, like, you know, rollovers and race cars and people who have, you know, these harnesses that, you know, NASCAR and racing cars. They've done so much to make it safe. They have like 7 different points. You're completely strapped into the roll cage and you know, and the helmet is strapped into the straps so it doesn't what happened to him doesn't pull your head off the spinal cord. You don't snap that and stuff. And so, yeah, they walk away from it, and we think, oh, rollovers aren't so dangerous. Oh, no, not in a consumer vehicle. They're super dangerous. Super, I understand now. Wow. If you suddenly start rolling at 60 miles an hour, oh, you're going to be tossed around there inside that vehicle. And, you know, you're lucky if you survive. So I was the last, I saw the penultimate in the dream. This is what I saw. A terrible rollover accident. Wow, that just happened in our family. And then after that, I looked up and then I saw the road was, instead of the road continuing on, it just dead-ended into this huge mountain. This huge mountain, completely dead-ended. A massive mountain. I said, what? And then in the middle of this mountain where the road was this huge black hole, it looked like a tunnel. That was just pitch black. Darkness, severe darkness. And I saw that, and then I just said, uh-oh. You know, what does that signify? Severe despair. Severe despair. Darkness, blackness, going into a time of great despair. So, the remembering that dream, I said, uh-oh. This is amazingly evocative. It's an attention getter, to say the very least, because this was just, I mean, this is the last thing I expected would happen. We're just stunned by it. We think that cars are safe. No, I mean, I'm sure they had the best car money could buy, and she was wearing her seatbelt. Yeah, she was. And no, we're not. See, we're overconfident in our, not only our safety, but we're overconfident thinking that we can handle despair, cure despair. We can turn away from God and yet still handle the despair that this causes. And guess what? We can't. We cannot. And eventually, pride goeth before a fall. Eventually, that fall is going to come. And what it will cause is psychic disturbances, where you will feel that you've kind of lost your stability, and you end up becoming something that you really never thought you could possibly become, and you don't really want to be that. So there are ways to see through all this, and I saw through it today in many ways. Okay, we don't need to stress out about that at this moment. It's just important here to get the big picture of what's coming here. You don't want to feel like you're a stranger to yourself. You don't want to feel like this alienated, super alienated from yourself. You don't want to become that which you despise, that which you say, I never want to be like this, and yet now I am like this. You never want to have this mental feeling, a mental split in your mind, which trying to cure despair ultimately produces this terrible mental, imaginary mental split in your mind, like the mind is now split in two. The more you try to cure despair, the more your mind feels split in two, actually. And if you really try all the way to cure despair, you'll end up with mental chaos. And so all this stuff is coming down the road. The Dharma Kings know about it. They absolutely know about it. I know about it. They've informed me of just a general outline. I don't have the details. And it's probably a good thing. I don't want to be overburdened, because I might become overconfident. You know, you don't want to be overconfident. You want to be careful about the situation, actually. So my advocacy is to wake up to the situation and turn back to God now. But we're turning back to a much clearer understanding of God now. But the basics are still there. There's a higher power. There's a greater destiny. Somehow we're estranged from God. Or we feel estranged. This here, this world, we're sinners. This is a lowly place. Okay. This is where sinners end up in this world. And we need to reconcile ourselves with God in some way. This is the basic religion. But the grace of God enables the reconciliation to take place. In other words, it heals the so-called split. It's an imaginary split. What it really is bad habits and continuity fear. But it feels like we're kind of, the mind feels sort of split. It's imagining that it's split, that it split off from itself somehow, which it didn't. But at least religion touches upon all these points. And that is absolutely right to do so. And people pray and ask God for help. Now, again, that's touching upon the right point. There's a lot of raggedness, of course, in all of this. A lot of confusion. But it's, at least they're touching on the right points. And at least it doesn't make despair a lot worse. Whereas the humanistic approach makes despair much, much worse. It compounds it severely. That's why we have to keep getting stronger and stronger. You know, medicines treat more and more severe mental problems and illnesses and plagues and everything. All those are expressions of our despair, our inner despair. The make-believe despair, the pretend despair, the belief believed in despair of a self that can despair. There's no self that can despair, actually, at all. But see, we think that we want to have this make-believe self without the despair. But the whole purpose of this make-believe the self is to try out severe despair on it to see how it can handle it. So that when we separate from God, the real self will think that it knows how to handle the despair of separation. So you get that? So the entire design and purpose of this dream is despair, actually. So we need to give it a different purpose. is to set down the whole experiment, the whole silly rehearsal, dress rehearsal. So we can't have our cake and eat it too. We can't have a make-believe self believing that that is the self without feeling split mind and despair. So when we try to cure despair and we try to keep the make-believe self, make it happy, a happy make-believe self with no despair, that's actually, we increase the belief in the split mind. We increase the belief because we say now that this imaginary self is a happy imaginary self. And that signifies it's really managed to separate, right? Somehow, or we've successfully separated. It actually makes it worse. It actually makes it worse. So we do not directly address suffering, actually. What we say is, I've never suffered. I have never, ever suffered at all. Because this is a statement of the real self. Of course, if we're speaking on behalf of the make-believe self, we'll say, of course you suffered. Oh yeah, I've really suffered so much terrible stuff and misery. Well, we've suffered make-believe misery, yeah, make-believe self, but not real misery at all. What I am can never suffer any misery. So what we do for mind to recognize mind is say, I've never suffered. I've never suffered the slightest bit. I'm incapable of suffering at all, totally incapable. This is the right way to practice. This is what the Dharma Kings recommend. This is the right way to practice. And so I concur with them through my own experience. I concur with what they're saying. And I say, it certainly fits with my experiencing, no question about it. And it also fits with reason. But for most of us, we'll just say, wow, you know, this is like a huge leap of faith and trust, isn't it? Well, it would be if we hadn't done the work to really look into it. Yeah. But if we've really looked into this and applied ourselves and worked out in this way, then we would say, yeah, that certainly fits. The shoe fits, doesn't it? It really does. Now, there's another angle to all this. The question is, what do we do? And that angle is, I see two scenarios. One, you try to help out those who are struggling here with their bad approaches, or those who have the right approach to encourage them to maintain it, right? And the second option is you sidestep it and back off. And this second option would be if this whole scenario is really designed to try and drag all the Dharma Kings, all of the grace of God, drag it down into a black hole. So it it too believes in despair and believes the imaginary self is actually really suffering. And this is the ego's goal. It says that if we're all deluded, then everything's okay. And this is trying to rehearse again for separation, saying if we all separate, all aspects of spirit separate from God, all of us do it, then we'll all be happy. This is what the ego, this is what we believe. That's our key to trying to separate it successfully, is we all have to do it. But if some of us don't, then we'll still be in despair because we'll feel separated from part of ourself, you know. But if all of the one self separates from the one self, which is a ludicrous statement, but this is what we're believing in, then we'll all be happy. So this could be just a massive trap to try to pull everyone down into despair. And therefore, if that's the case, then you just sidestep it. You go somewhere else. And then by doing that, you show, wow, this isn't going to work. It really failed. This attempt to trap everyone really failed severely. And then you have to rethink all of your logic. You have to rethink, wait a minute, what am I doing here? What's my advisor advising me? It's not right. Something's not right. So it's one of those two scenarios. I'm not sure exactly how it's going to play out. You know, a lot of people from different faiths believe they're going to go to the pure lands, to paradise, to in Christianity, the place that Jesus has provided for us, his dwelling place, that he said he would leave to get a dwelling place ready for us. So at the end times, he'd come back and take us there. That's what Jesus said. At least that's what they... That's what it's written that he said. Other traditions also have ideas about going to paradise or the pure lands or something like that when things get real bad here. So those are the two possibilities I see. I don't know which one is going to play out at this point. I'm ready for either one, actually. Sometimes it looks like you can help, and other times it looks like it's all a trap. That they're just pretending, help, 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 pretending like, I need help. But they're really not asking for genuine help. They're just acting like they're calling for help, to pull you down into their confusion and despair and misery. So they think that way, you know, we'll all be saved. If we all are miserable, no one's miserable. And this is, again, an idiotic position, is it not? If we're all miserable, then no one's miserable. Because this is based on what? Contrast. So the ego... The ego system of logic is based on contrast. It's based on contrast. And so it says, hey, if we're all miserable, nobody's miserable. If we're all insane, nobody's insane. This is the ego's standpoint. This is its bedrock belief, that if we're all in the same boat, then the boat's got to be wonderful. This is, if we're all like drowning in the ocean, then we're not drowning. Right? If we're all drowning in an ocean of despair, we're not drowning. This is its logic. That's what its logic's based on. So it's leading us to that. It wants all of us to just be pulled down as far as possible. And then it thinks that no problem. It's no contrast. Misery loves company. If we're all miserable, the belief is we're all fine. And I know from experience here in this world, that's exactly what many believe and what the ego believes and tries to teach us. It is, you're miserable, but the reason why you're miserable is because they're not over there. They're not. But if they were just miserable, you wouldn't be miserable. This is what the ego tells us. And this is what you actually get believing in when you're in the misery trip. Is that you start believing this is true. Says, yeah, those people with money, those terrible people, they're not miserable like me. I want them to be miserable too. And then I'll feel fine. Because we think that happiness comes through contrast. Whereas the Holy Spirit knows happiness is absolute. It has nothing to do with contrast. If you're miserable, you're miserable. But spirit can't be miserable. So it must be a make-believe rehearsal of pretense that we're engaged in. So I cannot be miserable. It's impossible for you to be miserable. I can only be blissful. I've always been nothing but blissful. That's all I've ever felt is pure bliss. That's all I'll ever feel. So we need to practice in this way. So this is just, you know, giving you a big boost here. A big boost. I don't know where my big boost page went on Facebook. I can't find it. Someone viewed it, but I don't know where it went. I can't find it anymore. I can't access it. Funny. Again, Facebook is a strange place. Getting some bodhicitta grace merit by looking at these pictures and quotes of the Dharma kings. It's helpful. It's very helpful in some ways. But, you know, it's not a place where truth is being told, actually. It's not. Except for these Dharma kings, they tell it, but people... It's kind of like Ramana said, you know, repeating the name of a medicine, you have an illness, repeating the name of a medicine over and over and over, you know, that's not going to get it done. You got to take the medicine. And what we're doing is we're just kind of saying, yeah, the medicine, you know, I got some super mega medicine here. Great, super mega medicine, super mega medicine, super mega medicine. Now, this can be a step towards taking it. Okay, so I don't want to discourage anybody. I gotta be careful. It depends what your purpose is. If it's to lead everyone else into a trap, then it's bad. If it's to actually take the medicine, then it's good. So it depends what your motivation is, whether it's egoic or grace-based, your motivation. So, you know, there's somebody say, oh, help me, help me, help me, help me, but they're really trying to pull you into the tar pit with them. Oh, I'm stuck in the tar pit, help me. Oh, come on here, I can't move this. Come on, can you get a hold of this? And before you know it, they pulled you down into the tar pit. That's what they want to do. That's what the ego wants. And there's some that might genuinely want, can you help me out of the tar pit? And you can help. I don't know. It's difficult to discern. It's very difficult. It's very, very difficult. I give the benefit of doubt, but I don't know if that's right or not. It's obvious that people are stuck in egoic consciousness. Even spiritual people are stuck. It's no surprise at all. We've all either been stuck or are stuck. Okay, I certainly used to be stuck. I got pulled into the tar pit is what happened. So everyone said, help, 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 help. And what they do, they pulled me into the tar pit. It's like really bad. So I'm aware that this is certainly very prevalent. But also, you can generate by saying, super mega medicine, this medicine's great, I really trust it, super mega medicine. You can build up some sort of will and determination where at some point you just say, just take it. You know, you decide, okay, I can do it. But, you know, that's, it's got to have the right motivation behind it for this to take place. You have to really, really build up your trust more than intellectually. Okay, more than intellectually. You have to build up your trust, and you have to trust in the Holy Spirit to help build up your trust, right? So you have to believe you're guided by a higher power to do this. You have to believe you're guided by a higher power, not your intellect. Okay, not your word cleverness, not your education, none of that, but you're guided by a higher power, a flawless, perfect higher power. And you believe that this is true, and you pray and you accept it, and you're aware in that way, you interpret your life in that way, that everything that happens to you is grace, is helping you. Then, if that's your perspective, then you can, these things will help. They will help. But if you just have a humanistic perspective, it's actually going to make things worse. You're just trying to pull people down into the tar pit. So, you know, misery loves company. If we're all miserable, nobody is. This is the ego's belief system. If we're all miserable, nobody is. And this simply doesn't work. Much to your shock, you will find out. Much to your dismay, actually, for those who are involved in that. Now, I had a very interesting experience today. I went somewhere for a workout. I parked somewhere. The parking was hard to find, so I went to a different place and I parked there. And I thought there was a street that went through. So I was walking along and it didn't go through. And then I saw there was a back way along a hillside, but I have to go behind some houses. And it's intrusive. I said, I'm not going to intrude upon anyone's backyard area or anything. So I said, no. So I turned around and went back. And when I went back, I noticed these signs in people's yards I hadn't seen, which said, if you park here, you're going to be towed away. If anyone parking on here doesn't belong here, you'll be towed away at your expense. I've had that happen once. It's terrible. You come back, no vehicle. You have no idea what happened. that you think someone stole your vehicle. It's horrible. They should have to leave a note on a tree or note somehow, you know, before they do that, because you think your car has been stolen and you don't know who has it. It's horrible. I went through that once. It was just awful. So I noticed the signs. I said, oh my gosh, good thing I turned around and came back. I didn't want to take this dubious shortcut kind of thing of going behind the backyards. And I said, no, that saved me from being towed. Okay, so that's great. Then I'd start driving and ding, 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 ding. What's that? Orange light's on. I'm out of gas. I'm just about ready to run out of gas. I said, whoa, how did that happen? So I was fortunate enough. I was able to, I didn't know any gas stations where I was able to find one before I ran out of gas. So that's the second crisis averted. And then suddenly when I'm at gas, three motorcycle police pull up right on the other side of the gas dispensing area. So they're right there and looking. They're very close to me. And I'm just sitting there filling up the vehicle. And it's like, wow, that's never happened before to me. Three police. I said, well, at least I'm safe here. But it kind of got me thinking that three things happen in a row like this. I'm saying, wow. Let me say, so I go back and I'm working out, and then there's these two characters working out there. They were kind of dubious characters, sort of. I felt uneasy. Now, you know, nothing personal or anything. I just had this feeling, like, you know, the black hoodie, you know, and the way they are. You kind of feel like, you know, maybe these guys might be somewhat of dubious character, you know, in certain ways possible, right? Wouldn't be surprising. So I kind of said, I kind of maybe I should get out of here. And then I see someone else coming along, and they're like slouch. They have this walk, certain walk, like a perp walk, you know, like a criminal. And the way they look, the body language, everything, I said, wow, you know, this isn't good at all. You could just tell. It's kind of a slinky mongrel type of way of you know, being in the world. You just feel, you know, I said, I'm just getting out of here. And I just left. So I had three warnings there, three things that were potentially dangerous. And then it brings me back to the matriarchy, the patriarchy, and the mixture of the two. Those are three extremely dubious paths to take, okay? And most people are settling into one of these three camps, okay? They're really settling into it. And they're all very boosterish, and they all think, you know, this is it. This is why you have this tremendous divide in the United States between the you know, Democrats and the Republicans. Is they're settling into different camps, and once you settle in those camps, then you're really committed. You get real committed to it. And then there's others that say, no, we're superior. We have this compromise thing, and that's the trickiest, worst thing of all, actually. It really is. It's better to be committed to just one or the other, matriarch or patriarchy, than it is to be committed to trying to combine the two and come up with a compromise. That is the worst thing there is, and that's what a lot of intellectuals do. Okay, they're the worst. They're the worst. I can deal with a radical feminist matriarch, and I can deal with a patriarchist, you know, and you know, but those who try to blend the two, they're very troublesome. Because no matter what you say, they can agree, yeah, I'm not really into that part of it. No, yeah, I'm not really into that. Yeah, I take the best of both. You know, I'd be able to get this. I'm very spiritual because I have the best of both. You know, this is the worst. This is the worst, the most dangerous. So this needs to be pointed out, because a lot of people are settling into that, or they seem to be. So I'm just sounding alarm that none of those three are the right way. And leave those three behind. Leave those three behind. It's funny, I did three sets of workouts, and that's when I left. These three are not, that's not it. This is really interesting. Now, on the day my cousin died, my on the other side of the family, a cousin, first cousin, fell and hit his head, and he's in the emergency room of the hospital right now, intensive care unit, with severe problems in a lot of different ways. And so we're really concerned about him. It's like, what is going on here? What is going on here? And then someone told me today, it comes in threes. Well, a friend of ours, her mother just died, and now we have a cousin died, and then this cousin's in severe trouble suddenly. And very suddenly, he was just fine. He just lost consciousness, fell down and hit his head. He was just in his house. He was standing up. He lost consciousness. It's like, wow. So it's another shocker. And then we had a dog in the extended family, which is really kind of the extended family dog, suddenly got ill and died very quickly. That was just a week before my cousin, 10 days before my cousin had her accident, you know? So this is just boom, 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 boom kind of thing. It one after the other. And I said, I told her, I've been saying, hey, you better be ready by the end of June. You better, and because July is going, it's going to start. Just going to start. Stuff is just going to start happening like popcorn. And it, boom! It certainly has. I was ready by June 24th. I said I need to be ready by June 24th. That time, and my cousin had her accident. I think like on the 27th or something like that. Yeah. And the dog died, I think, on about the 24th or something like that, you know. And stuff started immediately happening, June for me, June 24th, just like I said it would, exactly like I was told it would, exactly like it. Suddenly, sudden deaths, sudden accidents, sudden unexpected tragic stuff, boom, comes out of nowhere like that. It's shocking everybody. And I was told by the Holy Spirit, this is what's going to happen. It's going to happen on a global scale, on a scale of the country and the planet. And so we had better settle into the fourth option, which is the Dharma Kings. Dharma Kings are the fourth way, the fourth option. And this is the only option that works. The other three, actually, you find out it becomes much worse. The despair becomes worse because you end up having a bizarre defensive system around it. And then you really feel so alienated from your grace. You know, you just feel I've lost sight of grace entirely. What's happened to me? You know, and then you get suicidal. I drove up behind this Jeep today after this interesting incident I had working out, and right on the back, this huge sign, suicidal tendencies on the Jeep. That's its sticker, big sticker, suicidal tendencies. And I said, yeah, that's the world. You follow one of these three paths, either settle in with the matriarchy, settle in with the patriarchy, or settle in with a compromise, and you're courting suicidal tendencies, actually, because you'll feel alienated from yourself. End up feeling so alienated. And then you just desperately clutch at the flesh and clutch at the world, the materiality, or you start clutching at sickness and death just to save you from despair. A lot of people commit suicide, they're in despair, they don't know how to be saved from it. They just think there's no way. But there is a way. And that's just to say, I've never experienced despair at all. I'm incapable of experiencing any despair, and just affirm it. And we're not talking about the imaginary self. We're talking about the true self. So the way out of all this is to speak from the standpoint of the true self and to affirm from the standpoint of the true self. This is the settle into this. This is the right way. Settle into this. Speak and affirm from the standpoint of the true self. And of course, the Dharma Kings can do that because they realize they are the true self. There's no other self at all. So they're all about speaking from the standpoint of the true self. They absolutely are. Did get a workout in though today, and lower body. I didn't do, you know, overdo it. Got pretty strenuous, but it was okay. And then upper body, I did a bunch of upper body stuff too. So, you know, hit it pretty good today. And getting stronger, getting a little bit stronger, you know, slowly but surely. I've tried to get a little bit stronger, and I feel sort of different. You know, I feel sort of different. As I came across this guy, he's got these muscle cars too today. It's like a really amazing, three of them. Wow. I'm talking to him, and they're right there. I say, "Oh, look at these cars, these muscle cars." He looks, smiles, says, "Yeah." And so the fourth way of the Dharma Kings is like driving a muscle car. I mean, you got the horsepower there to get out of town. The other vehicles, they can't handle it. No way, no way. I said, "How much horsepower?" He says, "Ah, 650." Wow, yeah, this is stock, super stock. Wow, 650 horsepower. Okay. So that's very. I keep running now into all these muscle. It's really amazing. I keep running into muscle cars now, and people with a, I don't know what's going on. It's extraordinary. Something there, I don't know what. Now, it may have something to do with the fourth way, settling into that. People might say, hey, I want to settle into it, but I think I'm going to become like really like wimpy and shrivelly, because historically a lot of the hermits have been all, you know, starving to death, and they look terrible, and people just say, oh, that's icky, you know, I'm scared, I don't want to lose my self-image entirely here, you know, I don't, or they may just go grunge like this because they want to appear to be hip, super hip. You gotta look out for doing that. So don't go grunge. No. So sort of like if you're presenting this, I feel like I need to look presentable to people, so they say, well, okay, I'm not gonna just like turn into some, you know, shriveled old hermit or something. Or just look, I'm gonna lose just every vestige of dignity I ever possibly had. It's just gonna be, you know, wow, it's terrible. It scares the heck out of people. And we don't need to lose all that. No, there's no reason to. We don't need to go either way. You know, don't need to go with the fads or the anti-fad. Don't need to go grunge. We don't need to go grunge at all. We don't need to overdo the body beautiful thing, but we don't need to go grunge either. So maybe it has something to do with that. I don't know. Is trying to make myself, the people say, oh, okay, you know, he seems, you know, he looks like he's still got, you know, strong and in shape, and I can still stay in shape. You know, so many people that are been working out and in shape, the idea of this fourth way of speaking as the self, they might think that they're just going to get totally out of shape and become these, you know, useless blobs, you know, and it scares them. It scares the heck. I don't blame them at all. I don't blame anybody for saying, whoa, it's going to happen to me kind of thing. So I found that I feel better than ever in terms of my fitness. And so I look great. I'm in great shape. I'm tired because of these stressful tragedies keep happening in the world. I I'm still like, oh, you know, it's I'm doing everything I can do, so I'm tired. But as far as just kind of like my confidence, you know, it's very good. And so maybe, you know, so as I said, maybe that's it. I don't know. Maybe I'm just overcompensating. Who knows? But I seem to keep doing it. I want to get in some sort of shape, so it look like, okay, you know, believing in God doesn't mean that you have to be a desert hermit, or you have to, you know, be an ascetic and starve yourself and mutilate yourself and grow a long beard and long hair and never bathe and, you know, all this, you know, ascetic kind of. Because keep in mind that Buddha, Gautama Buddha, after he went through the trance meditative efforts and the self-mortification efforts of the body, he said, hey, neither one of those are the way. That's no. And he realized this is all just, all this stuff is just happening to an, is belief happenings to imagine, to a belief self. And it's much ado about nothing, because we don't need it. We can't separate from intrinsic spaciousness, oneness, God. So none of this is relevant at all. It's just a silly, whimsical, wishful thinking fantasy. And so he just went around. At that point, how he looked was like a prosperous businessman. Middle-aged, prosperous businessman is what he looked like. He looked very presentable into society. This is what we are told. And he was mocked initially. His friends, previous friends, they mocked him and said, who do you think you are telling us you had enlightenment? Obviously, you failed. Look at you. You're wearing nice clothes. You look like in good shape. You're well-fed. You're well-groomed. And you obviously sold out. And Buddha said, no, that's not true. Listen to what I have to say. So he began preaching to them, and gradually he won them over. But it took quite a bit of, you know, he really had to explain to them very clearly, and his presence was such that he did win them over. But initially, they were really scratching their heads. It's like, wow, this can't be legitimate, because, you know, but. So Buddha's saying, no, this is it. Don't you don't need to be some extreme in one way or the other in terms of how you present yourself in the world and such, and it's not necessary. So it's a good example. It's a good example, really. It really is. So I'm kind of in that mode of just a sort of a prosperous middle class business person kind of persona sort of thing, California cool, look. I'm just into that right now because I'm sort of feeling that, this can help people get away from radicalism, of all sorts, and help attract them to the path, because most people in this world right now are very much into their health and their looks and their health and all this kind of stuff. So to ask them to abandon that, that's ridiculous. You don't have to. You don't have to at all. You might even be better than you've ever eaten, more healthy than you've ever eaten. That's fine. That's fine. Take care of yourself. Nothing wrong with that. What's important is to settle into speaking and affirming from the standpoint of the true self. It might seem kind of weird at first, but I'll tell you what, it's nothing in comparison to, we don't want to talk in contrast, so it may seem a little weird, okay. But as far as suffering goes, as far as, it's nothing at all it compared to the weirdness that the ego is going to have people doing. Those that settle into the matriarchy or patriarchy or combination, they're going to be involved in stuff that is so weird. You if you knew what it was, you would just throw up right now. It's so weird. It's so repulsive. So just speaking from the standpoint of the self, okay, that's no trouble at all, really. Very little trouble. I've never been deluded. I've never been asleep. I never fell asleep. I never dreamed, really. You could say I've been imagining, but I never fell asleep. I never left myself. I never was unaware of what I am. I've never been unaware of what I am. See, this helps mind recognize mind. Okay, so this is a practice. It's just a way of helping mind recognize mind. So don't nitpick about what we're saying. Just ask, does this help mind recognize mind? If so, then it's fine. It's fine. That's the only test it needs to pass. It doesn't need to pass the ego's test of the ego's logic at all, because our only purpose is to help mind recognize mind. That's all we have to do. We don't have to solve any problems of an imaginary problems of imaginary self, of an imaginary world, of an imaginary universe. We don't need to solve any of those problems. Why should we solve imaginary problems of imaginary self? Why? Why should we do that? At least why should we be... Why should it concern us then to wake up, to for mind to recognize mind? We're still out of habit going to, take care of the body and do stuff like that, okay? That's okay. But as far as our emphasis, why should we be stressing it out and worrying about imaginary problems of an imaginary self? What does that have to do with me? Nothing. Nothing at all. This, as Jesus said, this world has nothing to do with what we are. Bodies have nothing to do with what we are. He says this world... And bodies, indeed, this universe tells us nothing at all about what we are. So why should we be frantically trying to change it and do stuff to it? And so it has nothing at all. It's all imaginary. It's imaginary, and we are not imaginary. So it's an imaginary universe for an imaginary self with imaginary despair designed into it, imaginary impermanence, all this. Why should we worry about any of that? And why should we try to do anything about it, so to speak? Other than if we want to be creative, that's fine. But why are we so caught up in that? We don't have to be so caught up in it. And that's religion helps us say, don't sweat it too much about this life and this body and such. It's not really important. It's not really important, actually. We place too much importance upon it, that's trouble. So the modern world has placed way too much importance on imaginary problems of an imaginary self, seeking imaginary solutions for it. What other kind of solutions could there be except imaginary or just the mind recognizing, the real solution, mind recognizing that mind is just mind and nothing other than that. It doesn't have to prepare for separation, actually. It doesn't have to. It's pointless, completely pointless. That's the real solution. But trying to solve imaginary problems of imaginary self, this is what strengthens the belief that the problems are real and the imaginary self is real, and we have to come up with some solution. We got to heal them. Why should we heal an imaginary self? You know, why should we work to try to make it feel happy? Why? Doesn't that just compound things? Make us think that it's a real self? So don't worry about imaginary self and how it feels, or how we believe it feels. And there's a creature walking around. I don't know what kind it is. Maybe a cat walking along. Why should we stress out trying to solve imaginary problems of imaginary self? Solve the one problem, which is continuity fear. All our bad habits, we need to put good habits into work. Don't attack the bad habits, just start making good habits. This is the way to do it. Just start building in good habits. The bad habits will just become less and less important in your life, and basically, you know, they'll just be phased out just from disinterest. They're just disinterest, so they're just phased out in that through disinterest. Just be disinterested. Ramana Maharshi said, you really stop all thoughts, just the only way is just stop being interested in them. He said, that's the only way to stop thoughts. You're just no longer interested in them. And when you realize they're just imaginary thoughts of an imaginary self, why should we be interested in that? It tells us nothing about ourselves. We don't need to be told anything about ourselves, really, except to be reminded that we're bliss and we can't suffer. We can't forget what we are. We've never forgotten what we are. Just keep affirming the truth about ourselves and turn it into a super positive. I've never forgotten myself at all. It's impossible to forget what I am. There's never been any forgetfulness. Say that. And mind will remember, oh yeah, I really am mind. Yeah, I didn't forget. I've been pretending to forget, but pretending is not the same as forgetting. You see, pretending to forget is we still are not forgetting. So we really can't forget what we are. So say, it's impossible for me to forget what I am. I have never forgotten what I am at all. Not at all. I know what I am. I haven't forgotten. I feel perfect. I've always felt perfect. Practice in this way. Again, mind recognizing that mind is mind. Mind recognizing what it is. Oh, I'm mind. I'm not a fantasy. I'm mind. And then as soon as we recognize, mind recognizes that it's mind, you know, that's it. That's it. That's what we're looking for. And that smooths everything out. Everything that's it's all smoothed out. Oh, the whole everything is clear. Just say, wow, nothing ever happened at all. Nothing ever happened at all. Say that. Nothing ever happened at all. Nothing ever happened at all. And say it. If you don't say it, then you just mentally have a thought or concept of it. You got to say it and believe it. And state it as an assertion that this is true. I'm telling, it's like mind telling itself what is true. Mind talking to mind. Mind, you know, talking to mind. I have never suffered. Nothing has ever happened. Nothing has ever happened at all. In fact, nothing can ever happen to me. I'm always 100% pure mind. Nothing's ever happened to me at all. This is how to practice. So settle into this style of practice, and we'll see what we can do. You know, this is our goal, to settle into this, settle into it. Some of these teachers, Hammers of Nisargadatta Maharaj, is very good Facebook page. If you can go and look at it, and maybe like it, and so it shows up in your feed, news feed. Say, click, you know, show up at the top of your news feed. There's a preference thing up there, so some button. And I think when you like it, you can go to the red little arrow that drops down and says, you know, show in my newsfeed, you know, all everything, yes, and top of the newsfeed or normal. Choose top of your newsfeed. And the Nisargadatta Maharaj is just, you know, he just hammers it beautifully. is a good term, hammers of Nisargadatta Maharaj. He says the right stuff. He says that he does. He pulls no punches. He says the right stuff. Basically, he does. He really does. So it's very fresh to hear that. Very wonderful to hear that. And don't be scared by him. Don't be scared by him. I used to be scared of Gaurav. He's fierce looking. He didn't used to be that way. But everybody, of course, tried to drag him down into the tar pit. So, you know, he got a little bit defensive and fierce. Say, hey, you're not dragging me down. You say this, I say this. He refused to be dragged down. And so he kind of changed. And a lot of people tried to take advantage of him. They weren't really serious. There's a lot of issues. He became more adamant as he got older. But it wasn't always that way like that. And Padmasambhava, Nyingma Masters is a very good web Facebook page. Nyingma Masters, N-Y-I-N-G-M-A, Masters. Picture of Padmasambhava there in the banner. It's like, wow. Very spacey. Oh my gosh. He's just like, something about him, you know, it's just, you just feel, wow. This is someone that is coming from a different perspective. From the enlightened perspective, yeah. He's all in. He's all in. Don't be scared of Padmasambhava. Yeah, so don't be scared. If you work on being less scared by them, and of course you might. I was certainly scared by both of them at first, and gradually I'm less scared of them. I just appreciate them. But you know, work on it. Work on it. Work on it. Work on it. Settle into it. Just settle into working on it. What else are you going to do? You're going to work on it. You're going to settle in somewhere, and you're going to work on settling into somewhere for sure. It is either going to be this, or it's going to be the matriarchy, or the patriarchy, or a combination of the two. Or just total nihilism, which is, you know, just suicidal tendency, and just pure nihilism of just, you know, just rioting and violence and nihilism and all, you know, this, which is just despair, you know, settling into despair. You can just try to settle into despair. So you're going to settle in somewhere, and you're going to work on getting comfortable there. Definitely are. Absolutely. Everyone is. So why not settle into getting used to these Dharma kings, the those who tell us the truth and tell us how to practice properly, and just work on settling in. There's nothing else to do here at this point. You just find out where you're going to settle in and work on it. So I'm doing everything I can do at this point of trying to make materials available. One of these videos, Facebook, I keep posting. And people just, you know, not many are settling into it. I don't feel there's a settling into it. But we all have to settle into something. We will. So beware that there's this idea that we're going to sit on a fence. Where's the fence when severe despair hits us? There's no fence. It's right in your face. You're feeling it. And when you're feeling severe despair, there's no fence. You say, I gotta get away from this. You don't say, well, I'm just gonna sit here on the fence and enjoy this severe despair. No. You're gonna settle into the severe despair then. Is what's going to happen. There's no fence there. So everybody's going to be settling into something and just accept it. I'm trying to be some sort of nihilistic superstar. You know, I'm above it. I'm not settling into anything. You know, this is, yes, you will. Dharma kings are settled into truth. All right, they're settled into truth. Absolutely. So we're going to either start, you know, settling into truth, or settling into lies. You know, basically, that's it. Where else is there to settle? Thinking that there's some third place to settle, that's settling into lies. Now we won't, you know, as we settle in, there's stuff, processes, stages or something will happen. We won't, you know, immediately settle into pure truth of knowing and this and that. But we'll go through the settling in situation where we make progress, we have breakthroughs, and ultimately we, you know, the various gets better and better and better and better and better. Might be enlightened and settle into enlightenment. But again, be very, very careful about spiritual paths. I advocate the path of speaking from the standpoint of the true self, of asserting from that standpoint, instead of just petitioning it. Because when you petition it, you think you're some other self that needs help and being happy. This is not true. So try to speak as if you were the true self and speak from that standpoint, and you're just trying to confirm for yourself that you know mind really is mind. Mind just confirming, yeah, I really am mind. And you can do that through assertions. I've never forgotten that I'm mind. I've never been other than mind. I've always known that I'm mind. I've never fallen asleep and thought that I was something else, actually. Nothing ever happened. Keep making, you know, more and more assertions like this. Speak from that standpoint. So that is the path I advocate. And a path that doesn't have that as their central practice like this, so the continuity fear practice and assertion practice of, from the standpoint of the true self, you know, I wouldn't settle into that, those paths. I wouldn't. Just a meditative path where we just meditate. I wouldn't settle into that at all. Meditation can be good if it's in the right context. If it's not in the right context, if you settle into a matriarchy and you're meditating within that, that, you know, the wheels are still going to come off. Or a patriarchy, or a mix, are the two mixed together. The wheels are still going to come off. Whew. Sneeze, a severe sneeze tried to hit me. That was tough to dissipate, that one. Wow. Wow, that was very powerful. Ooh. Okay, so settle in to the spiritual path that has speaking from this. You assert from the standpoint of the true self. I am the true self. I've always been the true self. There is no other self. I've always known this. I've never forgotten it. Nothing has happened. I've always felt blissful. I feel blissful now. I feel perfectly clear now. I feel perfectly blissful now. I've always felt this way. See, assert like this, just like this. And again, just saying the name of the medicine and not doing it is no good. Listening, say, oh, okay, and then not doing it. it's listening is helpful, but doing it is essential. Let's put it that way. So listening is helpful, yes, but doing it is essential. You have to actually assert yourself. You have to assert it in your mind. You got to. Have to. Wow, very nice backdrop here, huh? That's interesting. Yeah. It's almost like a palm tree is like there or something. You know, it's nice. It's very nice. Okay, how are we doing here on the video? Oh, wow, we're cooking right along. Wow, 122. Fabulous. So, I don't know how my other cousin is, other side of the family. We haven't heard word from him, but boy, you don't want to go into a hospital right now with multiple issues. You just don't. You want to stay out of the hospital. So call upon the Dharma Kings, the grace of God, to protect you. Call upon the grace of God to protect you in every way. Have my back in every which way. Now, I don't know what I'm going to do. I just keep trying and just trust it. You know, I can't get anything going on Facebook. You know, it's. But I'm getting used to Facebook. I mean, it could be a good tool. You know, I have to say this. They run a good site in terms of efficiency and a lot of stuff. It's amazing how functional it is. Actually, it's quite functional and fast. Oh, there's a cat walking by. Hello. And theoretically, it could be used. It would be very helpful use, put it to use, actually. But again, the will has to be there. The right will has to be there. You have to settle into this fourth option. Otherwise, it's just going to make things worse, actually. Social media can make things a lot worse, actually, and it's likely to do so. Social media is likely to really cause severe problems in the world. But there's nothing wrong with Facebook itself per se. I would, you know, I don't want to criticize the efforts of people who have made it and put it up and maintaining it and stuff. It's how you use it. It's the will of those who are using it. That's the question. But it's really, I mean, this is, it could be quite a good tool to use. Wow, I just put up these graphics. I found various ways to make it very striking, you know, and very helpful. Just like, and it's so quick and easy to do so, and it functions so well. I just like, wow, very functional. They've ironed out a lot of bugs out of it, right? It's been very much debugged in a lot of ways. Not everything, you know, not everything. That's not, you know, but runs pretty slick in a lot of ways. They've worked on it, and so I don't know. Will it be helpful? I hope so. But it's all, you know, it's up to the people. It's up to the each one of you. It's, you know, it's really nothing I can do. You can't make the horse drink. Lead it to water. Can't make it drink. You got it. You have to settle in to the fourth option. You have to settle into it. Find a way to settle into it. It's up. Use the genius, your own grace that the Holy Spirit gives you to settle into it. Because again, we're going to settle into something here, and it's going to become very apparent as we go forward what we have settled into. It's going to be very apparent. And you know, we try to use the pictures of the Dharma kings and their associates and Dharma princes, and we try not to use the pictures of anyone else. And those who have not settled into this, they you know, use a lot of pictures of various people. A lot of times it's feminine pictures, a lot of female pictures to try to highlight some quote or something. But you know, they're dressed like angels or in gossamer threads, or you know, so it's inappropriate. It's very inappropriate. That's a matriarchal sort of thing, or a patriarchal sort of thing, actually. Either one, it could be, or a combination thereof. We are not the body at all. The body is far removed. It's removed even from the imaginary self. We're not imaginary problems. We're not an imaginary body. We're not an imaginary self. So put our attention on those who know this for a fact and are helping with this. And don't post pictures of other bodies, basically, as much as you can, you know. Really, this should be one of the rules. And don't post politics and social issues. Those are, again, our attention is on asserting from the standpoint of the true self. That's what works. So our attention is on what works. This is just, we're pragmatists here. You know, how could anyone argue with that? You know, put your attention on what works. Why should we put our attention on what doesn't work? That is just, you know, idiocy. And it's the ego's idiocy that if we're all miserable, then there's no misery. We're not miserable. What? No, we'll all just be miserable. As if we're all miserable, that changes reality or something. No. So it's folly to put your attention on what doesn't work. So we just put our attention on what works. That's all. But I'm just getting used to Facebook and the politics of it and how it works. And at some point, I have to find some way to lay down the rules. There's basic rules. You know, you don't drag body imagery in there, unless it's the Dharma kings and their associates and the court of the Dharma king, so to speak. And you don't drag dogs, animals in there. Okay, it's another very important point. You don't drag animals in there. Animals are heavily used by those who are taking the other three options. We don't need the animal thing in option number four at all. It's very distracting. Very, you know, cute animal. This is what the ego tells us. It is, don't worry, you'll all be miserable, but you have a nice dog, and the dog will cheer you up. The ego tells you, oh yeah, the dog or the cat, that's what you need. That's the cure. That you can be really, it'll cheer you up. Well, it'll cheer you up, but it's not the cure at all. And you'll kick the can down the road, and you know it doesn't work. It causes even more split in your mind, which causes a reincarnation, actually. because you start splitting your mind and believing that that what you are is self and non-self, that the imaginary self splits, imagines it as a split mind, part of its spirit, the other part is an idiot, stupid idiot that you can't seem to get rid of despair, and that's the one that lives in the realm of despair, which we call a human life. And so and that's what causes reincarnation, is this imaginary split in the imaginary self. It's all that causes it. When you see it's all just an imaginary self, imaginary problem, there's no more reincarnation at all. It's just poof, gone. The whole dynamic behind it is evaporated. So when we try to solve despair through matriarchy, patriarchy, combination, and believe despair is real and the self is imaginary self is real, this only makes the belief in the split worse, which causes again reincarnation of the stupid part. The stupid part couldn't cure despair, so it has to live in a realm of despair. Whereas the other part, it knew the way, but the stupid part couldn't understand how to do it. So when we try to cure despair in the wrong way and try to deal with, make illusions true and get rid of them, this brings about a believed in split in the imaginary mind, severe split of part that said, well, I gave you the right instructions, but there's some part of the mind that doesn't know how to follow the right instructions, so it's like stupid and bad, and it has to dwell in a suffering realm, a realm of despair. And so we find what we think is ourselves here in this world, which is a despairing realm. This is what happens. This is what happens. What was that? I don't know. It's all imaginary. It's all completely imaginary. But so the wages of sin, or what we call it death, meaning you find yourself back in the death realm, or at least you find an imaginary self. You believe you're in a death realm again when you do not allow yourself to be saved by grace, not by works, but by grace. This is super important. Works are the matriarchal system, the patriarchal system, and a combination. Those believe in works. The fourth way believes in grace, salvation through grace. The grace of God, which just reminds us, this is all imaginary. Nothing ever happened to you. Nothing can happen to you. You're fine. You've always been perfect. Nothing went wrong. Nothing went haywire. Nothing whatsoever went haywire. This is the fourth way. This is salvation by grace. And this is the only way that works. And so, again, hear this. Take it to heart. Take it to heart. I've been preaching along these lines all along. Along these lines, it's just becoming very clear now that this was the right path to take. This is the path that results in clarity, and it's bearing fruit. It's proving that this is so. It's becoming easy to see now what's going on. And it's so easy to see. We don't even need hard to comment about politics or the Pope or various things. We just see, of course, so that's what they're up to. Okay, it's easy to see it. That's not the fourth way, not really. Let's combine grace and works, or let's combine matriarch or patriarchal. No. It's not. There's two real selves at all. There's just one, and there's only been one, and nothing has ever happened at all to it. Nothing. It's always been. It's perfect right now. I feel perfect right now. I am perfect right now. I've never not been perfect. There's nothing I need to do to be perfect. There's nothing I need to do to be blissful whatsoever. I don't need to do anything at all to be blissful. Say that. I don't need to do anything at all to be blissful. I am already blissful right now. And there's nothing I can do to ever change that. Nothing I can do to ever change that. And this is true for everyone. There's only one. Infinite self, and this is the truth of it. So I don't know what I'm gonna do. Wander into Facebook again. You never know. It's interesting seeing the cleverness of people and how they want to try to pull you into their tar pit. they may be ambivalent about it. Maybe they're asking for help, maybe not. Extend a hand, and I say, okay, I'll try to pull you out, and they're pulling me down, and you know, say, okay, here's where you need to go, settle into here. You just see the psyche, you know, at work, the whole thing, the whole psyche, is just, you can see it at work. it's you know, it's tragic that we're having so much trouble settling into what works, and keep trying to settle into something else, and thinking that, you know, if we just all settle into the same thing, can't be wrong. That's the ego. If we all settle into lies, lies must be true. This is what the ego believes. There's this logic. So be careful if you're following the ego. Really understand where it's leading you. It believes if we all settle into lies entirely, then lies will be true, and we'll all be happy, therefore. Thereby. And there's not a shred of truth that it doesn't work at all. It's a complete disaster failure. And you'll be shocked, you know, if you should go down that road. You just say, I thought it would work. I thought this has to work in some way. No, it doesn't work at all. Then you just say, oh my gosh, you know, what do I do now? We tried to all settle in here with lies, and now we see it doesn't work at all. Only problem with working out is you have more muscles, but you have more muscles to ache. See, I tried to get rid of all my aches and pains by just not having any muscles at all. And it kind of worked, but then I was a blob. And I said, well, that's I can't get around so well. That's kind of a problem, too. So I need some muscles to get around. And so I got muscles now, but they all can ache. It's not like you feel great, really. Yeah, there's probably some medium where it's all flexible, you know, really wiry. The best is be wiry and flexible, actually. That's really the best. See, you don't have too many muscles to ache, but you'll still ache. if it can ache, it will. So you never feel that great, but what could you do, right? You put up with it. I put up with ache. I don't take any medicine. You know, that medicine is a slippery road to go down. I've had our doctors tell me this. I've had med techs tell me this. They confide. They say, hey, look, people tend to confide in me. And they tell me wisdom, their wisdom, because I'm willing to listen to it. They could tell, here's someone who's actually going to listen to me. Hallelujah. Because I have something important to say. So everybody has something important to say. So listen to them. They'll tell you what it is. Everyone has a life lesson they've learned. It's a very important thing, and they'll tell you if you're willing to hear it. And they can say, oh, someone's willing to listen. Thank God. I thought no one would ever listen to me. And he said, hey, don't take medicine. You know, don't take it. Every medicine has side effects, and you will start compounding more medicine to deal with those other side effects, and it's just, they say it's a road to hell. It goes down. So if I'm achy, sore, pain, nothing. I don't take anything. I just pray. I just asked Jamyang Gyantse Chokyi Lodo, I say, hey, Jamyang, you know, this is getting in the way. Let's not let anything get in the way here. Help me out here. Boom, he helps me out. Which is really just the grace of God, but this is just giving it a focus, you know, that helps me with my habits, my bad habits, which are, you know, concretization, which is all our bad habits. It helps out to have some focal point. And in some way, it's true. He's a brother that's helping us. So it's also true in that way. I just say, got this, you know, pain or ache, or just, you know, let's, I don't need it. Let's take care of it. It's yours to take care of. It's yours. And he takes care of it. Pretty amazing, but I've experienced this now. I keep experiencing it. You know, he's an action guru. He'll take care of it. Action guru, you got to feel very comfortable with at the level of action. The Dharma kings, you know, the ones that we've, Jesus, etc. I feel kind of uncomfortable with them at the level of action. I just, like, I don't want to ask you to really help me with this ache or pain. You know, it's like it's beneath you or something. You know, it's like, wow. But with Jamyang, I feel that's okay. Hey, Jamyang, I've got this, you know, issue. My wrist, or, you know, sore right now. It's going to pain me and distract me from my path. Please take care of it, because I don't want to be distracted from my path. I don't want anything to distract me. And you know what? 10 seconds later, the pain's gone. It's like that. Now, for everybody, it might be different depending on your faith. I say it's yours. It's your pain to deal with now, not mine. So you adjudicate this pain. I put it in your hands to adjudicate it. And I feel comfortable doing that with him. I don't think he's put off by it. You know, I think he's delighted by it, actually, that we have this kind of faith in him. I believe he's delighted by it, and it just makes him weep that we're putting this kind of faith and trust in him. Because he comes from a tradition, like Longchenpa was kind of overlooked too. And this tends to be overlooked in the world at large, you know. And they don't want to be overlooked because they're helpful. They want to help us. So by asking him, also St. Jude, if you want to ask Christian tradition, St. Jude, he was very badly overlooked. A lot of people ask St. Jude for help, and he helps them. He really does. So absolutely put it in their hands. Say, it's your pain now, not mine. And you do whatever you want to with it. It's up to you. I trust you. I trust you. But just don't, I don't want to be distracted from the path in any way. Don't let anything distract me from the path and the momentum I have. Just clear everything out that could be any problem whatsoever. It's in your hands. My path is in your hands now. And I feel comfortable with him in that way. I feel he can relate. He's lived the life here and suffered, you know, from the Tibetan, you know, the invasion of Tibet and the cultural genocide of Tibet and all that. And yeah, he's gone through a life here recently that and his personality is such that he just has this. He's very approachable. I mean, when he approaches you, you feel very comfortable with that approach. His approach puts you at ease and comfort. And that's a great attribute to have, for sure. Very helpful. He's an action guru. He'll do the miracles, actually. He seems to be very comfortable doing that. He was asked many, many times to give empowerments. Everywhere he went, people asked him to do healings and empowerments and stuff. And he did them. He did them. He loved doing it. He always was doing various empowerment rituals and things from all different eight approaches of Tibetan Buddhism. And he did them flawlessly. And people loved to ask him to do this because they could see that he would do it exactly right and effectively. So he's an action guru. He's an action guru, very much action guru. To put, you know, I highly recommend Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro and call upon him. And again, his life was such that he accumulated empowerments, almost an unprecedented amount of empowerments he accumulated for himself. He embodied all of that, and then he poured out these empowerments on everyone. They'd say, do this ritual empowerment for us, and he'd do it in a perfect way. And everything he did was flawless, and people just say, wow. It's so profound. And then someone else from another tradition would ask him, and he'd do the same for them. And he was equally facile in all of them and loved all equally, didn't have any preference. He was supremely ecumenical. So he will have no trouble in empowering you in whichever way you feel comfortable. He doesn't have a trip to lay on you. That's how I feel. There's no trip he's laying on us. He's not laying a Tibetan Buddhist trip on us at all. He's saying, you know, put it in my hands, and I'll take care of it in a way you feel comfortable with. This is a true action guru. So we're blessed with this true action guru that's just, you know, been fairly recently in the world. And his students went on to become the real bigwigs of Tibetan Buddhism, and now their students, the third generation, are now coming up, and they're also the bigwigs of Tibetan Buddhism. So he's a super, super important aspect of modern Buddhism. Really, the patriarch, or not the patriarch, but the heart of modern Tibetan Buddhism has really came through Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro. It really did. It really did. And he's the supreme action guru, Dharma King, an action guru. And they are able to put you at ease and do these miracles for you. Absolutely do them for you. So, you know, it's up to your faith and other factors that I can't predict or say, you know. But for me, I've had many, many occasions now where I feel he's done something for me. Many occasions. And he's even confirmed that, yeah, indeed, I'm the one that did this. He gave me a powerful confirmation of that. I was in a real bad situation, everything turned it, cleaned it up perfectly well. He confirmed that he was the one that was looking out for me in this situation. I said, wow, okay, you're getting more requests then. The gurus want requests. They don't want us to ignore them, say, no, you can't do this for me. No, they say, hey, you can do this for me. I know, I believe you can, I know you can. And I trust you just like I trust myself. So you're just me in a more clear state of mind. This is all you are. This is what I feel. He's just the same as me, but in a more clear state of mind. So it's basically me doing it for myself also. It's just that there's this sort of me in a more clear state of mind. Here comes another cat. This is the friendly one. Wow. Hi. Hi, kitty. Oh, it's just walking by me. This is a very beautiful cat. This is the one that gives me positive boosts. But right now, it's maybe it realized I'm taping, so it didn't come over. But it might come over. Very beautiful, powerful cat that gives these really great positive boosts, always has to me. It just silently wandered past and it looked at me. It wasn't scared, just kind of looked at me like, yeah, I got your back, don't worry. Isn't that amazing how we're talking about Jamyang Kenchi Choki Lodro and this powerful Dharma cat just comes walking past. Wow. Doesn't often do that. Very rare. Very rare. So I just let him go past. That's fine. It's evening and the cats are, you know, moving around. And who knows what the cats do or why they move around. But they always seem to have a purpose, don't they, cats? Oftentimes their purpose is sleeping. And they're very purposeful about that. I think they go into a, you know, blissful condition when they sleep. They kind of dissociate from the body, consciousness entirely. And they're just, you know, just so blissed out. We had a cat that was like that. It was blissed out always, but when it was sleeping, and then when it would wake up from the sleeping, it was just completely blissed out. And it would just remain with it, you know. That blissful condition would just remain. It's like it went into samadhi when it slept. It was just extraordinary. You could just see it. I said, the cat's in bliss. What is this? It's very strong bliss. It wasn't just ordinary happiness. The cat was just, it would just seem like it had just traveled to the pure land. It had been dwelling in, you know, this pure land. And that returning here, it kept the vibrancy and the vibe of the Pure Land, the ambience, it kept it so wonderfully. Yeah, so that gave me a boost for sure. It helped out a lot. If you're fortunate enough to have an animal like that, who's truly like that, then this can help. This can help, actually. But we don't bring animals into our, you know, if we've pictures and graphics and stuff. No. That sets a wrong tone, actually. It really does. And it's funny, this Dharma cat that I have was blessed with. Someone gave it to me. It's a great blessing, actually. It didn't like having its picture taken, our videos taken. Obviously, it disagreed vehemently with that. It said, I don't want you posting pictures. I tried to post pictures. Something always went wrong. I got this feeling that it absolutely did not want me to do that. It would turn away. Something would happen to the camera. And I realized, hey, this cat doesn't saying, don't put my picture up or post pictures of me online or do anything with me. I don't want, that's not the right emphasis. I'm not here for that. I'm not just some ordinary cat. They say, look, what a cute cat. What a nice cat. He says, that's not what I'm here for. So I got the message strong and clear throughout the years. So I don't do it. I don't do it. I've thought about posting pictures. No. Cat says, don't. So don't post animal pictures online. This is really important. People are going crazy about that. Animal Planet, you know, this is not the way. It's not the way at all. This is very much in a mode of one of the three ways that don't work. Very much so. But if you happen to be blessed with an animal that you see seems to bring in this bliss, true bliss, then just accept the blessing. But still, you need to practice from the standpoint of the true self. You absolutely have to. Okay? Don't think the animal can do it for you. No. So people are relying too much on animals. That's why this cat left. It says, you know, I don't want you to rely too much on me. You have this tendency, you get going towards relying too much on me. So I'm going to pass away now. I said, yeah, I said, you don't have to. I know you don't have to. Because I know you could get well. Because I know you're a Dharma cat. And the cat, you know, agreed. Said, yeah, I know. but I'm going to go anyway. It's okay. Don't worry. I'm fine. It got cancer, and it died from cancer. We didn't euthanize it. No, don't you euthanize me. I know what I'm doing. I'm just leaving this realm because I don't want you to get over-attached and over-reliant upon me. You got to, and it's been very helpful that it passed away. Just over the last week, I was right here coming to tape, and suddenly I thought I saw the cat. It was like right there. And right here, and I just, oh my gosh, I addressed it. I said, how are you? Wow. And because its grave is right here. It's buried right here where we're taping this Dharma cat. Just like, 3 feet away from us right now. So it's here. It's here. This cat, actually I had a dream of a cat last night, came to me. A couple cats came to me in a dream, a very profound dream. This cat has gone to me many times in a dream now to give me major boosts. This cat, it was a Himalayan Siamese, interestingly. So it comes from the Himalayas, which is Tibet. It comes from Tibet, that area, Nepal, Tibet, Bhutan. That cat, that's its ancestry. And it was just an extraordinary Dharma cat. And so I think it was sent by the Tibetans. Someone gave it to me. They couldn't, they had moved into an apartment, they couldn't have pets, and so they just dumped it on me. And I said, what are you doing? I don't want a cat. And I was kind of scared of the cat, because I figured this cat was something different about it. But this is how I got the cat. Just one day I came home and says, guess what? We got a new cat. I said, what are you talking about? I don't want any more cats. I'm through with them. And they say, well, this guy, he can't, no place to put it. So we said, why as well, we'll take it. I said, no, that's terrible. So I was against it at first, very against it. So this cat was sent here for a purpose and then left for a purpose. And I said, you can get well. You don't have to die. I know you don't have to. And the cat just looked at me, just in bliss and said, I know, I could get well. I have the capacity to do that. I said, use one of your 9 lives. Well, this is the cat that was hit by a truck going 40 miles an hour and was lying to either side of the road, and a neighbor picked it up, and the cat thought the cat's dead. And then suddenly the cat came back to life in her arms and jumped out of her arms and ran off. That we thought he was just, was going to go somewhere and die because he must be terribly injured. Well, later that night, I think it was, in the middle of the night, I hear a sound, or somehow I wasn't sleeping or something. I went in to check. I said, is that a sound? I went in to check. There the cat was sleeping on the sofa. I said, oh my God, you must be so injured. And the cat just had a slight limp, was hardly injured at all. And everybody was astonished at this, just astonished. I said, wow, you just cheated death there for sure. And the cat acted like nothing had happened. I said, I'm back, everything's fine. But it was a little shaken up for a week or so. I said, don't go up that street anymore. Come on. So I said, yeah, I know you can, you can get better. But it said, no, it's okay. I can help you from the other side. I'll help you from the other side. And I said, okay, you be sure and do that. And true to its word, it has helped me. If I pray to that cat, it shows up in dreams like a guru. And I get, it's just like one time in a dream, it came to visit us. And I just like, oh my God, you came to visit. This is fantastic. We were just overjoyed. The cat came into the room, went around the house saying hello to everybody, and everybody was just like, just weeping. It just says, oh gosh, and you just feel the whole house being filled with super positivity. You just feel it. Immediately the house lit up, like it was lit up with super positivity. The cat just brought this super positivity into our home. So the cat was a guru, had this guru consciousness in it, really. It really did. And that's guru consciousness coming into your house. But you accept it easily. A cat is more easy than a cat than accept a human guru. It's tough like coming to your house. But a cat, yeah, sure, come on in. Very, very nicely done. And wow, just thinking of that is just, it's intense. To see that cat now, we would all just, everybody be flocking and just, oh my gosh, let me say hello to you. And the cat, this cat directly looked into your eyes when you spoke with it and paid attention more than any human pays attention, and it responded. If you spoke to it, it would meow, like that. Do you understand why I say meow? So how are you feeling today? Meow. And it knew when you were addressing it, and it would respond back to you. It was amazing. You have conversations with it, and it was completely responsive to you. it had all these different tones of voice, and like it was talking with you. You swear that it was holding, it knew exactly what you were saying, and was talking back in cat language, the language of bliss, to you. Response. I said, yeah, I know what you're saying. I get it. Okay, yeah, that's fine. I say, hey, what do you do? I says, oh, I'm just, you know, want to go out. I say, hey, no, I can't go out. But, but I want to go out. So I'd end up letting it out. I'll be careful out there. Don't worry, I'll be fine. And you sure look back, like, yeah, I mean, I'll be fine, like that. And it never, ever ran away from me. Like when it snuck out or got out or something, well, and I'd say, hey, I don't want you to stay out. And it would just kind of, I said, don't run away, and just kind of go back and look at me. Any other cat would have run away. This cat never ran away. And if I said, no, I really want you to come back, then I'd walk up to it and just pick it up and say, okay, you know, it's all right. I'll do what you say. It's just amazing, amazing. That cat, it would not act in a cat way, you know. Cat way, it sneaks outside. Hey, come here, kitty. No, I don't think so. I think I'm going to want, you know, I'm not going to really let you catch me. But no, not this one. If you say, hey, wait, stop. It would just stop. And then you could walk up to it and just pick it up, and it wouldn't try to slink away or anything like that. And having had cats my whole life, I said, wow, this is very, very different kind of cat. You can't really classify it as a normal cat at all. And it wasn't. It wasn't at all. And the cat before that also was absolutely extraordinary cat. People swore up and down this was not a cat at all. That cat, same thing. It would look at you, and you could tell it knew exactly what you were thinking. It was reading your mind, and I would try it out. It would know exactly what you were thinking. It was completely psychic, that cat. But it said, hey, don't make any big deal about it. These people are making too much big deals about animals. And it left too. It just disappeared. Probably like Pamasava, it just turned into light. A cat, it could have just turned into light, that cat, actually. And people said, oh, something bad happened. I don't agree. I think it may have just turned into light. Maybe it was Padmasambhava, that cat, actually. People said, this cat is just extraordinary. You cannot classify it as a cat, really. It was completely fearless. Big, massive dogs would come charging to it, towards it, full blast. You know, the cat would do is just calmly walk right towards the dog and then start, like, running right at the dog's face. And the dog just go, ah! The cat was totally fearless. It walked across town 13 times or something, all the way across town, miles and miles, to come back to this area. And finally, the owners gave up trying to find it because it kept showing up here. And, I mean, how in the world did this cat walk all the way across town 13 different times? It blew everyone's mind, but it did. And it, you know, it knew the way perfectly all the way across, you know, just extraordinary, this cat. So, yeah, I knew it was some kind of guru. I just, there's no question. And if I tried to treat it like an ordinary cat, it would nip me and say, no. I'm not here for that. I'm not an ordinary cat here. I'm here to discipline you on the spiritual path. I'm here to help you get serious. It was very like a taskmaster, like a guru. The cat was like a guru. You know, he says, you do things the right way now. You know, stop fooling around here. Don't fool around. So very helpful. So if you're really on the path, you know, you can have animals that are actually have this, can have a guru consciousness in them. It is possible. It is. But again, don't try to idolize them and put their pictures up on Facebook and stuff. No. They don't like that. They really don't like that. Said wrong emphasis. Wrong emphasis here. So I don't know what I'll do. I may start a group on Facebook. It's possible. I see some teachers, the quote unquote teachers, have started Facebook groups and stuff, and people can join the group. I tried joining one today. I don't know if I've gotten permission to join it yet, though. We'll see. Maybe they say we don't want that guy because he's too adamant. You know, fourth way, speak from the standpoint of the self. Don't speak from the standpoint of imaginary self. Speak from the standpoint of the true self. So I am the true self. I've never suffered at all. I've never split. I've never had any mental troubles. I've never had a slightest problem. That's all just a belief, the belief self, the imaginary self. But really, what I am, I've never had the slightest trouble. I've always been immaculate. I've always been immaculately blissful and fearless and powerful and creative, and there's no such thing that can bother me at all. I've never been the slightest bit bothered by in any way. See, talk like this. Talk like Sri Sri Dhanamayama. You know, because she would talk this way. They'd say, are we inconveniencing you? She'd say, what are you talking about? I've never been inconvenienced. Nothing can inconvenience me in the slightest regard. Well, you're sad or sad? What's sad? It's impossible for me to be sad. I'm just blissful all the time. Nothing bothers me. I don't even know what bother means. It's impossible for me. Talk like that. Talk like Sri Sri Anandamayi. I spent so much time with her that I, you know, kind of rubbed off on me. Like, maybe I can talk like this. Instead of saying, oh, Ma, you're so wonderful. She wants you to talk like her. Assert, be like that. Assert this. Assert it. The cat's moving around. I don't know. You never know when they'll just they show up like out of thin air, kind of. I look at you and say, just be as you are, they say. Don't let me bother you. A dog will come, of course. Dog will either bark at you or come up and, you know, start nuzzling you and, you know, disrupt you. But a cat, this cat's very cool. Just looked at me and says, oh, okay, I see you. I see your taping. No worries. Don't be disturbed by me. I won't disturb you. I'll just keep on moving by. See, the cat got it. Behave very appropriately. Dogs behave very inappropriately, actually. They really do. They really are very intrusive. Very intrusive. They break your concentration, you know, they intrude upon you, demanding attention, you know, affection, giving you so much affection. But yeah, the cat saw, I'm focused here, I'm spiritually focused, and I'm not going to mess with that focus. You know, the cat got it. It just looked very clearly at me and said, okay, I see you're busy, not going to bother you at all. See, that's being intrepid, that's the right way. Had a dog today come up to me, very nice dog, but very intrusive, you know. You know, bumping you, nuzzling you, looking at you, because, you know, just being the sort of center of attention, affectionate commotion sort of thing. You don't really want an affectionate commotion. You don't really, that's not bliss. That's affection. You know, bliss is something different. We don't really want an affectionate commotion that dogs bring. Cat and bliss will just sit there quietly. If you want to come up and pet the cat, hello, okay, nice, and then you leave it alone, it doesn't move. You know, it doesn't impose itself upon you. That cat, when it was hungry, it would find a way coming into my room. It's not supposed to, but it would sneak in, and then it would just sit there like this. First, it would sit by the door. If I didn't pay attention after 10 minutes, it would come in, sit by my chair. I'm at the computer, and just sit there quietly, like for 10 or 15 minutes, not moving. And then, if I didn't respond then I'd feel a faint tap, tap, tap on my leg. And so it would just put its paw up and just tap, tap, tap. And then it would just go back to sitting quietly for another 15 minutes, not moving. And then it would tap again, tap, 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 a little stronger, tap. And then it would again sit quietly. And then if I didn't pay attention, then I felt it was, at some point, you know, enough tap, 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 it would get up on its hind legs and tap me up higher up, you know, tap, 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 like, hey. And then it would go back down and sit. And then if I didn't respond to all its tapping, which progressive tapping, then it would gently put a claw into my clothing and kind of snag it, pull on it with his claw. And I'd say, oh, no, 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 no. But if then I didn't pay attention, then it would kind of like snag me, like try to, you know, go somewhere like it was like it was going to snag me. And it knew that finally would get me. And I said, no, 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 don't snag my shirt. Come back, come back. Okay, 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 okay. Then I'd get up and feed the cat. So it always went through this little ritual of being so polite. You know, not wanting to interrupt what I was doing. You see, it understood I was doing something important. It didn't just come right up and bug me. In other words, it gave me time to kind of sort of wrap up what I was doing. I didn't really get that, you know. I should have. I didn't do a very good job. I should have understood. I didn't understand what great manners it was displaying. That's amazing. I kind of just would keep ignoring it. But I really should have understood that it was actually enabling me to wrap up what I'm doing. So it wouldn't be a sharp continuity break. See, just like extraordinarily wise manners the cat had. Wow, I got to thank the cat for that. It's that cat is aware on the other side, very aware. And sometimes I ask it, I say, have your cat buddies help us out. Have the cat kingdom help us out. The cat kingdom can do wonders, really. I've always loved cats. I've always really loved cats. I have a very strong connection with cats. I get along extremely well with cats. And I feel like they've got something that's really intrepid, you know, really they do. Great poise and intrepidness and manners. Both the last two cats I had had extremely good manners. Impeccable. They were so impeccable. They never intruded. They understood what you were feeling and they would back off. I mean, it was amazing the emotional awareness those cats had. Just extraordinary. Impeccable manners. Wow. I gotta call on both of them. I haven't called on the other one. Actually, two cats showed up last night in my dream. So the way they were dressed was really weird, though. They were like dressed in with like cut branches. One of them had like all these small cut branches, like an oleander or something. And that was like their coat was these branches. What are they dressed in that for? Undercover? Maybe they're like undercover. So they're showing me, yeah, I was undercover guru or something. Interesting. I said, that's a very good disguise. Like you're under the bushes or something. You're carrying your cover with you. So he's like, oh, he's undercover. So the cat was saying to me, yeah, I was undercover. And they jumped up on the bed where I was and they spent time with me there. It was like very wonderful. Like, wow, maybe these cats were undercover gurus, actually. It's very possible. They're super helpful in my life. Really, really saved my life in some ways. So I didn't fall into the trap of despair. They said, no, there's a better way to deal with it here. Bliss. You know, I assert that I've always been blissful. I've never suffered despair at all. I don't even know what despair is. Say that. I don't even know what despair is. I've never despaired. I don't even know what despair is. I never can know despair. No one can know despair. There's no self that can know despair. I'm the only self there is, and that this one self cannot know despair at all. Cannot know the despair of existence because existence doesn't exist. How can I know the despair of existence because existence doesn't exist? Time doesn't exist at all. So affirm that. Affirm it. Don't beg it. Don't be a beggar. Affirm it. We are the self. We are the mind. We're not beggars. Don't beg. Affirm. Say, I can't possibly be harmed. It's impossible for me to suffer harm. Totally impossible. Nothing can happen to me. Absolutely nothing can happen to me. Nothing's ever happened to me. Never. Assert that and believe in it. And you'll feel something within your psyche like, wow. Some kind of sort of, you know, whatever. You don't need to label it even. You just feel something. Don't bother even labeling it. You just feel something. So again, settle into something. I have to keep nagging about that because settle into this fourth way of just we'll just be making assertions essentially. You know, we'll just settle into it. It's a nice lifestyle. It's great lifestyle. You just all these great teachers, Dharma kings, made assertions. They made so many assertions for us. We settle into their assertions. We settle into our assertions, and this is our lifestyle. We practice making these assertions and get more and more settled into it. So we play the familiarity card, which is the decisive card in all of this. We play the familiarity card. So settle into it. You know, I produce graphics. I can produce many graphics rapidly, actually. I have a seemingly endless bag of graphics, really nice ones. I can produce those and put assertions on them, and you can just, you know, practice getting settled into these assertions. Get used to it. Say, yeah. Now, it seems like many people they don't want to join Facebook at all. But I could put on a blog. Facebook is pretty quick and pretty easy to use. But you know, nobody's seeming to settle into it. But I don't know what I'm going to do. It it's so rapid in adding graphics, and so easy, very easy, and easy to delete, easy to change. I can add text to it. It's a super handy tool, actually, I'm finding. Very handy to put graphics and quotes, etc. It can only handle short quotes, very short quotes, actually, but which is good. Short quotes are good. Actually, that helps out. Less wordiness is better, actually. Just, I trust it, you know, super great quote, trust it. So here we are winding down, and we've done a pretty good job on this video, haven't we? Yeah, another 2-hour buster. To me, 2 hours is, you know, just a good, nice, good workout. Nothing too severe at this point. So yeah, I've gotten better and better and better at it. I was singing today, singing pretty darn good. Singing, you know, wow. You know, I had the Brian Wilson voice. I was still a little short of the high chorus, the end of fun, 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 which is the real tester, actually. If you really want to test your high voice, the end of the song, fun, 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 where he goes, woo, woo, fun, 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 and her daddy takes the keyboard away, woo, fun, 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 till her daddy takes the keyboard away, fun, da, 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 like that. The end of that song, you know, Brian Wilson goes way up there. And I was hitting it. The way to hit it, I have to sing it real loud and strong, and then I could hold it and hit it. But it's a real tester. So if I don't sing it strong, my voice breaks. But if I sing it really strong, I was able to hit that high note of Wilson there, Brian. He was the ingredient that made the Beach Boys something else. Set them apart. The other guys were great too, you know, all of them. Al Jardine sings great. Carl sings great. Mike Love sings great. Dennis sings okay. But basically, you had three great singers in that band. And musician-wise, they're all great. But then Brian Wilson was just a genius. And his voice just adds something to the Beach Boys that just puts it over the top. Really does. Wow. Just the way it sounds. And that was natural. His natural voice was that high voice. It's amazing. He was deaf in one ear, too. I think his right ear. I'm pretty deaf in my right ear right now because blockage of wax or something. It just keeps blocking up. Sometimes it blocks up. I can't hear anything out of my right ear. So I said, "Wow, that's like Brian Wilson." I think it was his right ear. I said, "Well, does that help you? Maybe it helps you. You know, maybe God says, yeah, that'll help you. Okay, maybe it will." So I'm hitting the Beach Boy high notes of Wilson. I'm able to sing most of it, but it's still not at the stamina. It breaks up, breaks up. But yeah, it could come around. It really could. But music isn't it. This is very important. Sex, drugs, rock and roll. That's not it. Music can never deal with despair the way that it has to be dealt with, which is to make assertions that you've never had it in the first place. I've never had any despair at all. So what are we doing using music therapy to help us out with despair? That's not it. That's not it. Gotta be very careful with music. Really very careful. So super slippery slope. All that stuff is super slippery slope. Anything you try to do, even graphics, is a slippery slope. You know, what works is say, I've never had any despair at all. What do you mean, my despair? I don't know what you're talking about. Despair. I have no idea what you're talking about. I've never experienced despair ever. Say that. People say you're going to denial. Well, no, I'm just denying what's not true. That's all. If something's not true, why shouldn't I deny it? Say that. I've never experienced any despair. That's the truth. And it's also denial that I'm even capable of it. I'm not capable of it. I'm not capable of experiencing despair. I'm absolutely incapable of experiencing despair. Even the tiniest shred of it. Absolutely incapable of this. This is how to practice. And so music is not practicing in this way, okay? It's not. I'm not sure how to use music in the right way. It's still not clear to me, actually. It can be very slippery slope. by harmonizing, it was better. I was able to harmonize going downwards. That's really difficult. I mean, very few can do that. I've never been able to do it. I was actually going, stepping down into harmonize and stepping it, boom, 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 boom. Like, whoa. You know, I haven't been able to do that before. Suddenly I was doing that today. And it's like, yeah, that's really cool because you don't hear it very often. You know, I can't sing at all here because I got to be quiet. I'm outside. I can't belt out, suddenly start belting out the Beach Boys, you know. In my vehicle, with all the windows closed, I can belt it out. Believe me, I can belt it. So it sounds pretty good. And believe it or not, I can sing pretty well. I could hold my own. You know, I could hold my own in a band, you'd have to say. I would assume I could hold my own. And, you know, very creative. So I'm able to do really creative vocal arrangements and spontaneously do that. I'm very good at spontaneously just inventing all sorts of vocal arrangements and sounds that are really, they're cool. They're really cool sounds. I like them. I hear them. I say, wow, that's a really cool sound. I'm very picky, you know, aficionado with vocals and music. So if I say, wow, that's really cool, you know, it sounds good. But if it does, it's not cool. I say, no, it doesn't sound good at all. That's terrible. I got no hesitation to say something sounds terrible. If I sound terrible, I'll say, ah, sounds terrible. But if something sounds great, I'll say, wow, that's really cool. I like that. And so, a lot of cool vocals. A lot of cool vocals. When you harmonize with the Beach Boys, the vocals come out super cool, actually. Just super cool. You can make the Beach Boys song sound better. That was like, wow, that's great. And I was doing George Jones too. I can harmonize with him, and his songs sound, you know, really great too. So, wow, it's really, really cool sound. Harmonizing with honky tonk, wow, it's really awesome, actually. It sort of gives a Beach Boy sound to honky tonk music. It's cross between Beach Boys and honky tonk, and that's like yeah. How come we don't have a band that does, you know, California honky tonk sound? That's pretty cool music, I'll tell you. It really is. Beach honky tonk. Beach Boy honky tonk music. Wow. Wow, that would be really cool, actually. It's a different style. Nobody's done it. Nobody's done that, actually. That would really sound interesting. And I do some of that. I tried it out today. But it's just music. You know, music is trying to cure despair, basically. Or it can just be expression of confidence of the self. It can just be a direct expression of just supreme bliss. It's possible to sing in just that way. It is possible. Sri Sri Nanamama sung a lot. So did Chandra Sering Chodron. Was always sang. She sang all her questions to Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro. She was always singing him questions and poetry and stuff. She didn't talk very much. She usually sang it. Sang it. Wonderful, blessed sister within the court of the Dharma King, you know. Really, very much so. So Sri Sri Nandamaya Ma sang a lot. We don't know about Longchenpa or Jesus. Or Ramana didn't sing too much, I don't think. He maybe sang a little bit. But those two that I mentioned sang a lot. And they were singing from the standpoint of bliss. So you can sing. It is possible to sing. An enlightened one can sing and it be a transmission of bliss. It is possible. But otherwise, you got to be careful about music. This can just be sort of enthusiasm to try and dispel despair. And Anandamayi Maharaj's singing, she was very ragged. She clear voice a lot, you know, and her voice would get faint sometimes. And she wasn't trying to be some professional singer, really. It came from the heart, came from bliss entirely. And she sometimes she stop and talk, you know, what this okay, can you over there to give instructions? Okay, let's start again. Krishna Kesava, Krishna Kesava, Krishna Kesava Pahimam, Rama 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 Rama, Rama 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 Ram. Then Krishna Kesava, Krishna Kesava, Krishna Kesava Pahimam. Rama 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 Ram. Krishna Kesava Krishna Kesava, you know. Krishna Kesava Krishna 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 Pahimam Pahimam. It's hard to do it quietly. Pahimam. It doesn't quite come out, but it's okay, Pahimam. Krishna, 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 Pahimam. Ramana, 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 Ram. And so she go like that, and it's just like beautiful. You're just like, but not in a, in a soulful way. It's just something like celestial, kind of just. Not like she's singing a power ballad at all. No. It's just endearing, like a little child singing. She's like, it sounds like a little child singing, actually. Yeah, that's right. We could do, in the parking lot, woo, 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 ah. We're always first to hit the lot and wave to the man in blue, yeah. Yeah. Could do that. Just spacing out in supreme superlative spaciousness. Superlative infallible sameness. Supreme superlative spaciousness. Superlative infallible sameness. Space out. And smooth, smooth, superlative spaciousness, space out in supreme, infallible sameness, space out in supreme spaciousness, space out in smooth, supreme spaciousness, space out in superlative, infallible sameness, space out in smooth, supreme spaciousness, space out in superlative, infallible sameness. So space out in supreme, smooth spaciousness. Space out in supremely smooth spaciousness. Space out in superlative, infallible sameness. Where does this come from? Well, of course, from one of our Dharma kings, Longchenpa. Wonderful affirmation. I space out. I space out as supremely smooth spaciousness. I space out as superlative, infallible sameness. Try that. Instead of saying, "Oh, I feel so in despair. I need a hug, a pat on the back." Yeah, I need some music. Listen to some music. I'm so inspired. No, just try this. Say, I space out. I space out as I am spaced out right now, as supremely smooth spaciousness. Supremely smooth spaciousness. I am spaced out right now as superlative, infallible sameness. Okay. And I'm always this way. I'm effortlessly this way. There's nothing I need to do to be this way. So this has just stopped me right in my tracks, and I'm just being aware of the wow within me. That's all. I'm just sort of being aware of it. It's reverberating very strongly in many ways. Like my whole landscape is shifting. So that's all I'm doing. My eyes are closed, just so I can just kind of help me be aware of just this reverberation that's happening. It struck me very strongly, that assertion. So I'm not trying to be quiet or do anything. I'm just quietly allowing the reverberation to happen, and just noticing it is kind of peripherally, like the applause of if you're in a crowd at a baseball game, the people are talking and clapping and stuff. You're kind of just peripherally aware of it, all the noise, just taking it in sort of in that way. So sometimes you'll just stop right in your tracks like this, and you just feel it. It's something coming on strong, and you just don't move. It's like an earthquake hit, an inner earthquake, a positive earthquake, having aftershocks kind of thing. Yep, aftershocks. Now, something's making a noise. I'm not really sure what it is. I don't want to open my eyes at this point. So sometimes you just feel like having your eyes closed. That's fine. Generally, I don't close my eyes, but sometimes I do. It's just not, trying to close them or anything. It just feels like I kind of need to shut off the external world here for just a bit, because the internal world's really kicking up the strong reverberations. It just feels like it makes more sense to pay attention to the inner landscape than the outer. Is all. Open my eyes a little bit here. Just don't really feel like opening them too much, but wow, I don't even feel like moving actually. Interesting. I feel like I'm like a statue almost. Wow. It's a lot easier to stay still right now than it is to move. It feels like normal. It feels like a statue. Effortlessly, I'm not trying to be a statue. I feel like a statue. Wow. When I started to move, it felt like I'm kind of abnormal there for a moment. It's like, wow. All my muscles are like at peace, sort of, and not relaxed, but sort of like a statue. There's just like no. It feels like I could just stay here. Like a statue for a long time, just. Not really aware of my body parts so much, you know? Like my hands and my feet, my legs. It just feels like all just one body without any parts to it. So I sort of lost body consciousness a little bit. It receded. It sort of receded. my consciousness is perfectly fine. You know, clear, alert, no trouble at all. I seem to have not much body consciousness, not much thinking consciousness at all. Just kind of clear. You know, smoothness, just kind of what we were talking about, asserting. That sort of, you know, came upon me in a certain gentle way, a little bit, you might say. Like I'm supremely smooth, spaced out, and supremely smooth spaciousness. Yeah. Spaced out in superlative infallible sameness.